Hey guys, so welcome back. In this video, we are continuing the question discussion for the krok. Well, let's start from the 69th question here. So when I'm speaking of 69th question, a patient with a fracture of his lower jaw was admitted to the maxillofacial department. It was decided to fix his bones surgically under anesthesia. Okay, so they want to fix the bones surgically under anesthesia. So whenever we give anesthesia, we do myo relaxation. So we use myorelaxant, but after giving myorelaxant, there is a short fibrillar contraction of the facial muscles. Okay, what muscle relaxant was applied? Now guys, let's look at basic physiology here. So when I'm speaking of basic physiology, if I consider this as a muscle ending, okay, and a nerve, so this is called as neuromuscular junction, right? So in a neuromuscular junction, what happens? Nerve ending will release something called as acetylcholine. Okay, now what happens to this acetylcholine? It will act on some receptor called as NM receptor. Now NM receptor is what? NM receptor is a type of cholinergic receptor which is present in the neuromuscular junction, right? Now whenever I stimulate this NM receptor with the acetylcholine, there is a contraction, right? Now what happened here? They gave some drug. Now after giving this drug, what happened? There is a contraction. If there is a contraction, means it is working similar to that of our acetylcholine, right? Now if it is working similar to that of acetylcholine, what happens? We have some drugs which is a molecule which is in a bigger size when compared to the acetylcholine. One of those molecule is called as Succinylcholine is what? Succinylcholine is a type of acetylcholine like molecule, but it is larger when compared to acetylcholine. Now what happens whenever I give this succinylcholine? What will happen? This succinylcholine will keep stimulating the NM receptor. When it keeps stimulating the NM receptor, what will happen? At one point, this stimulation will lead to something called as spastic paralysis. Okay, now after this spastic paralysis, what is happening? Paralysis means muscle is going relaxed, yes or no? Now what happened? Spastic paralysis has occurred. After this spastic paralysis, now one more thing, what happens? This succinylcholine molecule, I earlier told you, it is a bigger molecule. If it is a bigger molecule, it will remain there for a longer period of time in the neuromuscular junction. When it remains in the neuromuscular junction for a longer period of time, what will happen? Receptor desensitization. When there is a receptor desensitization, what happens? Again, further lead to the weakness of the muscle, causing the muscle relaxation. So first thing, it causes spastic paralysis, means spasm is occurring, means there is a depolarization occurring, yes or no? If there is a depolarization occurring, means what? It means it is causing myorelaxation along with a depolarization. We call it as depolarizing myorelaxant, right? So when I'm speaking of depolarizing myorelaxant, it is of succinylcholine. Well, we understood that. Now let's look more facts about succinylcholine. Succinylcholine is a type of molecule. Now succinylcholine drug, I will write as a SC, succinylcholine. Now succinylcholine is metabolized by an enzyme called as pseudocholinesterase. Now what happens to this pseudocholinesterase? Pseudocholinesterase is a enzyme which is required for the metabolism of succinylcholine. For example, if I had a patient which did not have this enzyme at all, now if he had a genetic deficiency of succinylcholinesterase or pseudocholinesterase, what will happen? Succinylcholine will remain in the body itself. When succinylcholine remains in the body itself, what will happen? His muscles will become paralyzed. Which of the most important muscles should be working all the time? That is our respiratory muscle. Now respiratory muscles are not working, he will go into respiratory arrest. He will go into what? Respiratory arrest. Respiratory arrest due to what? Deficiency of pseudocholinesterase. So deficiency of pseudocholinesterase will lead to what? Will lead to respiratory arrest. Now when I have a patient who is having such kind of respiratory arrest, what do I need to do? I need to do a simple thing. What is that simple thing which I have to do? That will be give a ventilation support. Now if I have a patient who will not recover after a succinyl choline injection, I will give ventilation. What type of ventilation? I am giving an artificial ventilation. What do I mean by artificial ventilation? Insert an endotracheal tube, give ventilation using the tube. This is called as artificial ventilation connecting to a ventilator. So this is a story of our acetylcholine. Now I am speaking about acetylcholine. What is this dithylenium? Acetylcholine in Ukraine, it comes under a brand name called as dithylenium. It comes under a brand name called as dithylenium. So dithylenium consists of what? Succinylmethionium or succinylcholine. Succinylcholine is a type of depolarizing myorelaxant. So this is a story of our 69th question. Now let's go to the 70th question. So when I'm speaking of this question, guys, let's look at this question. Very simple thing. An elderly patient, okay, he's an elder, means old patient. He is having what? Chronic constipation induced by large intestine hypotonia. Okay, we found out the logic. He is having what? Hypotonia. Where? Hypotonia in the large intestine means what, guys? He is having weakness or decreased tone, or decreased tone of what? Decreased tone of large intestine. When he has a decreased tone of large intestine, it will lead to what? Stool will remain, means large intestine is not contracting, means there is no peristalsis in the large intestine. If there is no peristalsis in the large intestine remain relaxed. When large intestine remain relaxed, the stool will not come out. Now the patient is undergoing constipation. Now very simple thing, increase the tone, increase the tone. At the same time, I need to get the stool out. So if I need to have my patient being normally able to pass his stools, I will use some group of drugs called as laxatives. Laxatives. When I'm speaking of laxatives, we have some group of laxatives called as bulk laxatives. Bulk laxatives are what? Bulk laxatives are a group of drugs which will increase the mass of the stool. How will they increase the mass of the stool? They will increase the mass of the stool by retaining more water in the intestine. So which drugs do that? Now one of the most important bulk laxative is castor oil. But here what is the problem? The problem is weakness of the large intestine. Means I need to have a laxative which stimulate the tone of the large intestine, The most important drug which stimulate the tone of the large intestine is our bisacodyl. Bisacodyl is what? Bisacodyl is a laxative. But what type of laxative? It is a type of stimulative laxative. What exactly it is stimulating? Please make a note out of this point. Stimulative laxative means it is increasing the tone of the large intestine. While as castor oil is what? Castor oil is a type of bulk laxative. So let's move on to the next question. When I'm speaking of the next question, the 71st question, a patient with epilepsy and a depressive reaction has been administered a drug that reduced epilepsy. Means a patient has some epilepsy along with depression. He was given some drug that reduced the epilepsy and improves the patient's psychic condition. So most important direct fact to be remembered, that will be our sodium valproate. Sodium valproate is such an anti-epileptic drug which has almost every possible anti-epileptic mechanism, that includes action on GABA, action on calcium receptor, calcium channels, sodium channels, such as sodium and calcium channel, AMPA and NMDA receptor. Okay, so it's a big story, simplified thing. Please remember, most wide variety of anti-epileptic drug which can be used in most of the types of epilepsy, apart from anti-epileptic action, the other actions are included only for this drug. It is a type of fact-based drug which you need to remember. Okay. Now, a patient was diagnosed with morphinism. Morphinism, it's not a proper word, but a patient was diagnosed with addiction of the morphine. What is morphine? Let's see. Morphine is what? Morphine is a opioid. It is a type of opioid. Okay. A patient diagnosed with morphinism has been administered to the narcological department. Okay. A doctor noted a decrease in the pharmacological activity of morphine. Repetitive use of the drug may result to the tolerance to its effect, and this phenomenon is called as, it's very simple, guys. We have a patient who is having morphinism, means he is using morphine repeatedly. Yes or no? When he is using morphine repeatedly, what will happen? This person will develop something called as tolerance. What is this tolerance means? For example, the patient was getting addicted for the morphine. When he took for having fun, when he took a first shot of morphine, what happened? He got high and he enjoyed that euphoria. Now, after that, what happens? He will take a next step. When he takes next time, he will not get the same euphoria for the same dose, means he need more dosage to get the same effect. Tolerance is what? Requiring more dosage to get same effect. Get same effect. So it is more seen with, most commonly, which we can encounter in a alcoholics. What happens when the person drinks a beer or some alcohol for the first time? He will get some high, but what happens when he drinks second, third time? He will need more alcohol to get the same effect. So that is our tolerance. Tolerance will lead to what? Tolerance will lead to addiction. Addiction means what? Addiction means the person will become dependent on that particular substance. So what do I mean by dependent? Means his emotional condition will become in such a way that he will have pathological craving. Means without that substance, he always have crave for that substance. Forgetting that substance, he might do anything. That is called as addiction. That is called as addiction, right? Okay. Chalo, let's go to the next question. When I'm speaking of the next question, examination of a 60-year-old patient revealed that hyperglycemia and glucosuria. So he's having what? Hyperglycemia means more blood glucose level, and glucosuria. What is glucosuria? Glucosuria means, glucosuria is nothing but presence of glucose in urine. Now, a doctor administered him a medication for a internal use, means he is using the drug orally. What medication it is? That drug would be gibenclamide. Why gibenclamide? Because it is a type of oral hypoglycemic agent. What is it? Oral hypoglycemic agent. Now, what exactly does this oral hypoglycemic agent? Is such a kind of drug. What it will do? It will increase the production of insulin. Now, what exactly, how exactly it increase the production of insulin? For example, let's recall for most important thing, where exactly insulin is produced from? Insulin is produced from the beta cells of the pancreas. Now, what happens if I consider this as a beta cell of a pancreas? Guys, what is this? This beta cell of a pancreas will contain some vesicles which is filled with insulin. Now, what happens whenever we eat food? It will allow glucose to go in. Okay, now once glucose goes inside, glucose undergoes oxidation and it will produce some ATP. Once ATP is produced, this ATP will go and act on something called as ATP sensitive potassium channels. It acts on what? ATP sensitive potassium channels. So they are potassium channels, but they are ATP sensitive. Means what? If they are ATP sensitive, whenever ATP is present, they will get closed. Okay. Now, by our physiology, we should know intracellular fluid is rich with our potassium ions. Now, what happens? Potassium will keep going, but when this channels closed, what will happen? Potassium will not go out. Potassium will start to increase inside the cell. Now, what is happening, guys? A positive ion increase in the cell, it will lead to depolarization. Whenever it gets depolarized, it will lead to the release of the insulin into the bloodstream. This is the mechanism of action of our gibenclamide. Gibenclamide is a type of oral hypoglycemic drug. How does it work? By blocking a potassium ATP sensitive potassium channels. Where exactly? In the beta cells of pancreas. Okay. Now, when I'm going to the 74th question, it is the same story. Now, let's go to the 75th question. When I'm speaking of 75th question, a patient suffering from stenocardia. Stenocardia means what? Angina. The patient is having angina. Now, what is angina, guys? Angina is nothing but a chest pain. Okay. He takes isosorbide mononitrate. Nitrates are one of the most important drugs which are used in the treatment of angina. He was prescribed a complementary drug with a disaggregating effect. Well, disaggregating is not exact word to be used. Well, rather than disaggregating, we can call it as anti-aggregation. Anti-aggregation effect. Now, what exactly is this anti-aggregation, guys? If I consider this as a blood vessel, now what happens? We have endothelium. Okay. Now what happens during a disease called as atherosclerosis? There is a fat accumulated where exactly? In the subendothelial space. Now when there is a fat accumulated inside this endothelium, what will happen? At one point, what will happen? The plaque will start to rupture. When plaque will start to rupture, what is this? Atherosclerotic plaque. when this endothelium ruptures, what my body will think? My body will think that I am bleeding because the circulating platelets will come into contact with the contact with the subendothelial tissue such as collagen. Now what will happen? My body will think that I am bleeding out. Wherever there is a disruption to the endothelium, platelet will come in contact with the collagen, leading to what? Platelet aggregation. Now when platelet aggregation occurs, what will happen? There is a decrease of blood supply. This part will suffer ischemia. Okay, we know this, but during platelet aggregation, what will happen? We have one substance that is arachidonic acid. Now this arachidonic acid, with the help of an enzyme COX-1, will get converted into something called as thromboxane A2. Well, with the help of COX-1, there are other substances formed, but here for our question, what we require is thromboxane A2. Now what is this thromboxane A2? Thromboxane A2 causes platelet aggregation. Platelet aggregation. Now what happens? Anti-aggregatory effect means this platelet should not aggregate. This platelet should not aggregate means we should block this enzyme. Which drug exactly block this enzyme? But irreversibly means irreversible COX-1 inhibitor. Irreversible COX-1 inhibitor. That irreversible COX-1 inhibitor is our acetyl salicylic acid, which could also be called as aspirin. Aspirin. Apart from that, aspirin have antipyretic and anti-inflammatory and analgetic effect. Okay, chalo, let's go to the next question. A patient in the post-operative period, post-operative means he had undergone a surgery, means he would have prescribed, for example, before surgery, he would have prescribed some myo relaxant. Okay, post-operative period, he was given what? He was given an anticholinesterase drug. Which drug? For the stimulation of the intestinal peristalsis and the tone of the urinary bladder. What drug it is? Okay, now guys, they spoke about something called as anticholinesterase. So we need to know what exactly is that. Now guys, when I consider this as a nerve ending and for example this as a smooth muscle cell, now what will happen? It is not just smooth muscle cell, it is a type of, when I consider it as a cholinergic neuron, what will happen? Every time this cholinergic neuron gets stimulated, what will happen? It will release something called as acetylcholine. Now acetylcholine will act on the cholinoreceptor which is present. Okay, now what happens in a cholinergic neuron? On the postsynaptic membrane, we have some acetylcholine receptors sitting. Okay, now guys, this acetylcholine will be metabolized by an enzyme called as ACHE, that is our acetylcholine esterase. So what happens with this acetylcholine esterase? It will be broken into acetate plus choline. Okay, now anticholinesterase means they will block this enzyme. If this enzyme is blocked, it will increase the acetylcholine. When acetylcholine is increased, what will happen? It will stimulate more of cholinoreceptor. Guys, remember, cholinoreceptors are a type of parasympathetic receptor. When I stimulate the parasympathetic activity, what will happen to the intestine? Intestinal peristalsis will increase. At the same time, urinary bladder tone will increase, causing the person to urinate. Means I had a patient who is undergoing surgery, I gave him myo relaxant, now he is having what? He is not having proper peristalsis and urinary bladder contraction. Now what I do? I need to cause the contraction, means I need to help the patient to urinate at the same time to pass the bowels. So for this purpose, I will give an anticholinesterase drug. That means that will block the acetylcholine esterase. So anticholinesterases increase the acetylcholine, causing the more stimulation of the acetylcholine receptor. So anticholinesterases are a group of drugs. They are cholinomimetics. But cholinomimetics means they are increasing the cholinergic activity. But are they directly working on the receptor? No, they are working by blocking an enzyme. If they are working by blocking an enzyme and increasing the acetylcholine activity, means what? Cholinomimetics. But they are indirect. Now when I am speaking of indirect cholinomimetics, guys, we have some drugs such as neostigmine. We have one more drug called as physostigmine. Now, apart from physostigmine and neostigmine, we have one more drug called as galantamine. Now, I want you to understand here, this physostigmine and galantamine can cross the blood-brain barrier. they can cross the blood brain barrier. If they can cross the blood brain barrier, they will have central nervous system effect. But when I'm speaking of neostigmine do not cross the blood brain barrier. If neostigmine do not cross the blood brain barrier, means what? If I no crossing of blood brain barrier, means if neostigmine has no crossing of blood brain barrier, no crossing. Means if I need a peripheral activity, means if I need the activity within the intestine, bladder, anywhere in the periphery, I can use neostigmine. What is the other name for neostigmine? The other name for neostigmine is proserin. So proserin is a drug which could be used in the treatment of post-operative ileus. Ileus is nothing but intestinal obstruction. Okay, chalo, let's go to the next question. A liquidator of a broken down at a nuclear power plant. Well, this is a liquidator broken down at a nuclear power plant who was irritated, complained about vomiting that occurs all of a sudden. Means the patient is having what? Vomiting. Okay. Now, we need to treat this person. If I need to treat this person, I need to use what? Antiemetics. Now, what are the antiemetics? There are multiple antiemetics. Well, I want you to understand, guys, vomiting is stimulated by few important receptors that include D2 receptor. D2 receptors are exclusively present in the central nervous system. D2 means dopaminergic receptor. Now, whenever I stimulate D2 receptor, where exactly of D2 receptor? D2 receptors of something called as CTZ, chemotrigger zone. When I stimulate this chemotrigger zone, that will lead to something called vomiting. Vomiting. Okay, now I have a patient who is vomiting, means he is having a stimulation of D2 receptor. Apart from D2 receptor, we have some other receptor that is include our 5-HT3. 5-HT3 means there our serotonin receptor. Okay, now what happens when I stimulate D2 receptor in the CTZ? That will cause vomiting. But understand, CTZ do not have blood brain barrier. If CTZ do not have blood brain barrier, what do I mean? I need to use a drug which don't have to cross the blood brain barrier, but the drugs which block the D2 receptor, please write down or note a point, that is D2 antagonist. We have two drugs. One of the drug D2 antagonist. We have one drug called as metoclopramide. And we have one more drug called as domperidone. Now, domperidone do not cross the blood brain barrier. But when I'm speaking of metoclopramide cross the blood brain barrier, means metoclopramide makes it to the brain, but domperidone do not make it to the brain. When it cross the blood brain barrier, well, one of them is CTZ is blocked, so antiemetic effect is achieved. But when it cross the blood brain barrier, it will block D2 receptor. If it block D2 receptor in the brain, what will happen, guys? When I block the D2 receptor, that will lead to one important thing, the increase of protein. Means if I stimulate D2 receptor, what will happen? They decrease the prolactin. But if I block D2 receptor, they increase the prolactin. If I stimulate, decrease. If I block, increase. If I increase the prolactin, what will happen? If I have a female patient, and for that female patient, if I prescribe the metoclopramide in a continuous dosages, that will lead to what? Prolactin increase, and prolactin increase will lead to infertility. How exactly prolactin causes infertility in female? It will block hypothalamo pituitary ovarian axis in a female, leading to what? Infertility. But I want you people to understand one more thing. We have some other group of 5-HT3 blocker. The drugs include ondansetron. Now, let's go to the next question. A patient with a chronic cardiac insufficiency, okay, he's having chronic cardiac insufficiency, has been treated with a cardiotonic drug. Cardiotonic drug means what? It is a type of drug which will stimulate the cardiac activity, that could be, might be digitals. Okay, and a thiazide diuretic. But in spite of there still edema and risk of ascites still exist. So they gave a diuretic, which is the diuretic? The diuretic given in this patient was thiazide diuretic. Even after giving a diuretic, the patient is having risk of edema. Means, so we have some diuretics, loop diuretics and thiazide diuretics. Now these two drugs, we use them in the conditions, for example, edema. Now even if I use this drug, if the person edema is not getting treated, I need to add one more drug that is called as potassium sparing drugs. What exactly these potassium sparing drugs do? Potassium sparing drugs have two groups. One of them is called as aldosterone antagonist. Aldosterone antagonist. And one more thing is called as membrane channel blocker. Membrane channel blocker. Guys, if I want you to understand this membrane channel blocker and aldosterone antagonist, let's look into our nephron. Now, if I consider this as a nephron and this is a DCT of a nephron, distal convoluted tubule, and let's consider this is a collecting duct of a nephron. In the collecting duct, we have two types of cells. One of them is called as P cells. P cells are nothing but principal cell. Another one is called as I cell. I cell is nothing but intercalated cell. Okay. In the P cell of a nephron, what will happen? If I take this as a P cell of a nephron, look. We have, this will be the luminal side. So if I take this cell, this will be the lumen of the nephron. And this will be called as basolateral side, or I can simplify it into blood cell, side of blood. Okay. Now what will happen? This principal cell has something called as aldosterone receptor. Aldosterone receptor. Whenever aldosterone is produced in the body, aldosterone will do what? It will stimulate the aldosterone receptor. It will give a signal to nucleus. Nucleus will give a signal for the production of protein. That protein will come and sit. That will be working as a channel. Now what this protein does? It will take the sodium inside the cell. At the same time, it will excrete potassium. It will excrete potassium. When potassium is being lost, what will happen? Sodium is being reabsorbed. If sodium is being reabsorbed, means what is happening? Sodium increase in the blood. If sodium goes, water goes with it. Water also increase. If sodium and water more inside the body, means fluid retention. Fluid retention will lead to edema. Now guys, what happens is, if I block this receptor, what will happen? No protein. If no protein means it will not take sodium. If sodium is not being reabsorbed to the blood, where it is going? It is going into the urine. If sodium goes in the urine, it will take water also with it. At the same time, it won't. If sodium is not reabsorbed, potassium is not being excreted. So potassium will not also excrete. So what happens? Along with the other diuretic, we combine this potassium sparing diuretic, that has aldosterone antagonist. The aldosterone antagonist include two drugs, that is called, one of them is spironolactone, and we have one more drug called as eplerenone. Now what these two drugs? The two drugs block this aldosterone receptor. When aldosterone receptor is blocked, means along with the other diuretic, for example, when I'm speaking of thiazide is working in the distal convoluted tubule here. Now I'm supporting the thiazide diuretics by adding what? By adding a potassium sparing diuretic. So this is how we can treat the edema. If that fails to resolve with the use of a thiazides and a loop diuretics, I need to add up one more drug, that will be our potassium sparing diuretic. So according to the question, what is the drug which could be used? We could use a potassium sparing diuretic, that will be our spironolactone. Okay guys, thank you very much. I will continue the other questions soon. Thank you.